Good morning. Just waiting for a little bit till maybe some other folks join. I think we can get started. So, Yanis, thank you for taking the time to present today. Excited to hear about Kubeflow. One of the projects or project areas that SIG is actually been looking at and reaching out to is MLOps. So that's SIG runtime, and you know how you run workloads in the cloud, and I think MLOps is one of the up and coming areas, and Kubeflow is one of the projects. I think it actually, you know, covers the whole scope of you know, end to end on how you deploy machine learning workloads, cloud native environments. So with that, I'll just you know, let you take it away.
It's great to be here, Ricardo. So should I start presenting my screen?
No, you don't see your screen.
Oh, I asked if I should start presenting. So I guess I should.
Sure. Yeah.
Okay. Can you see my screen now?
Yep.
Okay, let me get set up. I think everything is ready. So let's get started. Hi everyone, I'm Yanis. I'm a software engineer at Arito, and I'm also a contributor at Kubeflow and the lead for the Manifest working group and the Notebooks working group. So in this talk, I want to give you an idea of what Kubeflow is and the potential that it holds as a Kubernetes native ML solution. So first of all, let's talk a bit about what Kubeflow is. Kubeflow is a machine learning platform built on top of Kubernetes. And Kubeflow is dedicated to making deployment of machine learning workflows on Kubernetes simple, portable, and scalable. And many people, when they think about machine learning and what you do in a machine learning project, they think that most of the time is spent defining a novel model architecture, training it, and iterating on that. But the truth is more complicated. Usually, in reality, most of the effort needed is infrastructure and DevOps effort to address the various difficulties of the workflows of data science present. Configuration management, pipelines, reproducibility, serving, scalable hyperparameter tuning are all hard problems that all machine learning projects will face. And Kubeflow extends Kubernetes to natively support ML workflows in order to solve these hard DevOps problems and provide a cloud-native platform for machine learning. Now, Kubeflow is an open source project, as you know, and the product of many companies' collaboration. You can get involved by joining our Slack, our community meeting, or a specific working group you're interested in. So I feel that the best way to show you what Kubeflow is about is to actually present a quick demo of a machine learning workflow using Kubeflow. So in this demo, it's a live demo, we will put ourselves in the shoes of a data scientist starting a new machine learning project. We will start with the open vaccine Kaggle problem, which was a challenge to find the stable molecular structures for the COVID-19 vaccine. And we will first start with a Jupyter notebook and choose a machine learning algorithm to train our model. Then we will experiment with our data and run a reproducible MLOps pipeline. Then we will take that pipeline and run it with different parameters to perform what's called hyperparameter tuning to get the best model with the best accuracy. And finally, we will take the best model that we trained and serve it using Kubeflow's serverless machine learning serving solution, which is called KF Serving. So let's start with the first part of our demo. So let me actually switch to my browser. So as a data scientist, I want to start a new experiment. I'm going to the Kubeflow website, my Kubeflow deployment website. I'm greeted with a login page. So I'm logging in. And immediately I see the Kubeflow central dashboard. I want to start experimenting. So I probably want to create a new Jupyter notebook and load my code, load my data and get going. So I'm going to go to the notebooks tab and actually create a new Jupyter notebook server in this form. In order to not wait for the server to start, in this demo, I have prepared one beforehand here. It's called C Grand Time Demo. So all I'm going to do is connect to it. And once we resize the Jupyter Lab environment, what I have done here is actually clone a specific Git repository and open the open vaccine example. So in the Jupyter notebook here, you can see there is a number of steps from installing packages to loading and pre-processing the data, to defining a model, evaluating the model, and producing a final CSV file for submission. So as a data scientist, we have our Jupyter notebook where we experiment, we do things like that. And at some point, we are satisfied with the code that we have, and we want to actually run this code at a bigger scale, because a Jupyter notebook environment doesn't really scale that well. What we would like to have ideally is a pipeline which we can scale and parallelize and actually have something reproducible. So how do we go from having a Jupyter notebook to having an MLOps pipeline? Well, there is a tool called Kale, which is a Python SDK and a Jupyter Lab extension. And Kale is a project that aims to provide a seamless experience to the data scientists so that we can easily go from running our code locally to running a reproducible MLOps Kubeflow pipeline. So to enable Kale, we simply click on the sidebar, on the Kale button, and we click enable. Now you will see some colors over each cell. And this has some special meaning. So in Kale, the data scientist goes to each cell and annotates it. So a group of cells becomes actually a pipeline step. And data scientists can also declare dependencies on other pipeline steps. So without changing any of the actual code, we have gone from a Jupyter notebook to defining a pipeline-like structure. Now, all we have to do is click compile and run. And Kale will parse the notebook and generate a Kubeflow pipeline, which it will then submit. So I will do that to demonstrate now. And in addition, Kale ensures reproducibility by logging metadata about each pipeline step's inputs and outputs, and also taking snapshots of the notebook's volumes using ROC's CSI-compatible data management capabilities. ROC is a CSI-compatible data management software by Aricto. And finally, Kale gives us a link to the pipeline, which we can open and track its progress in the Kubeflow pipeline UI. So this was the first step of our demo. Now let's continue with our presentation. So as a data scientist, we have gone from experimenting with a Jupyter notebook to actually having a reproducible MLOps pipeline. Now we want to perform a procedure called hyperparameter tuning, where we run the same pipeline multiple times with different, with slightly different parameters in order to optimize the actual performance of our model. So in order to do that, we will use a Kubeflow component called Katib, which is which enables us to do hyperparameter tuning natively in Kubernetes. Again, Kale will help us by providing a very intuitive UX for that. So going back to our notebook, let's say now we want to do hyperparameter tuning. How do we do hyperparameter tuning? We need two things. The first thing we need is to actually declare what the hyperparameters are. What are the knobs that Katib will turn and see what happens? Those are defined in a special type of cell, which is called pipeline parameters. And the data scientist selects it from the UI like so. Then we need another thing, which is the actual objective. What is the Katib optimizing when it's turning a knob? What should it see to evaluate if it the result was better or worse? In this case, we optimize for validation loss, and to do that, we simply print the validation loss and tag the cell as pipeline metrics. Now that we have done these two things, we can enable HT tuning with Katib in the Kale deployment panel. Then click on setup Katib job to tune the various parameters. And once we are satisfied with it, we click on compile and run Katib job. And Kale will actually, again, take care of creating the Katib experiment and running all of these pipeline, all of those pipelines, in order to perform the hyperparameter tuning. Now, as before, Kale will actually give us a link to the Katib experiment where we can track its progress in the UI. Because for the purpose of this demo, the experiment would take a long time, I have prepared one beforehand again. So I'm going to delete this one. Okay, so let's continue. Now we have created our Jupyter notebook with our code, converted it to a reproducible MLOps pipeline, and produced the best model by performing hyperparameter tuning. Finally, we should simply take the best model and serve it. This is the serving part. So, as I said before, the the hyperparameter tuning process will take a long time, so I have prepared an experiment beforehand. So if I go to HP tuning, this is my experiment. As you can see, the HP tuning UI provides an intuitive UI to see how all of your trials went. And you can also see a complete list of the trials. And the best one is highlighted in yellow. So to serve this model, we'll navigate to the pipeline that produced it by clicking on the little pipeline icon next to it.
I have a question. Why is that the most optimal? So
that's a great question. So in our notebook, we defined some knobs, some parameters for CATI to tune, and we also defined an objective, which was the validation loss. So what this means is that this trial had the best validation loss.
I see. Got it. Yeah.
So that's what the UI highlights in this case.
So that's the lowest value. The lowest value, so 0.69, basically. Okay.
Exactly.
Got it. Thanks.
So we can go. From the HPTuning experiment, we easily find the best trial, and we go to the pipeline that produced it by clicking on the little pipeline icon. Now, to actually serve the model, we will restore the state of the notebook in this last step, the model evaluation. To do that, we will use actually what is Kubernetes CSI capabilities. In this case, we have ROC implementing them, which is a Rictus Data Management layer. So to do that, we will copy the snapshot URL and create a new notebook server, which will actually go to the state of that step. Let's name this serving demo. Yeah. And we launch it. And this will actually restore the notebook to the state of the last step of that pipeline. Now this will take a bit. So I have prepared again a notebook server that is ready for this. So to reiterate, the state of the notebook right now is at the last step of the best pipeline run. So we actually have our model in a variable called model. And we come, we go to our notebook and try to serve it. So to serve our model, we will use KF serving, which is Kubeflow serving solution. And KATIB's SDK will make it easier for us to serve the model without having to know everything about KF serving. So what we'll do is from the KL SDK, we'll import the serve function. And then we will define a KF serving server by giving it the model and a pre-processing function. So in machine learning serving workloads, it's common to have a pre-processing function before the.
Hey, Yanis. I think the audio went off. Okay. Yeah, I think we can hear you now.
Oh, you can. Great. Okay. Yeah. So, moving on, we define a pre-processing function, and give it also the model. So what KF serving will do is it will create a server for pre-processing and another one for predicting. But the data scientist doesn't need to know all of that. They just give the pre-processing function and the model in Python. So we run this cell, and in the background, Kale will take care of creating all the necessary KF serving API resources to actually serve that model. So now we will wait a tiny bit. And while Kale is actually doing all of this work, and we'll see the server in action. So while this is happening, are there any quick questions?
So you're using the built-in Kubeflow server mechanism, right? So you can have also other server mechanisms if you like to, right?
Yeah, so essentially KF serving is more of a, on the infrastructure side, it doesn't enforce a particular framework, for example. It can work with TensorFlow, with PyTorch, or with everything, basically. It uses a serverless model and supports scaling to zero, and uses actually Knative underneath to do that. And yes, it's pretty generic. It doesn't enforce any particular framework for machine learning or anything like that.
Got it. Thank you.
So now we're waiting for the inference service is an object from the KF serving API, and Kale is waiting for it to be ready, which should happen any second now. If there is another quick question, we can also do it now while the inference service becomes ready.
How long does it usually take to run? Or it depends?
It's usually faster, but if you remember earlier, we submitted the pipeline. And this is not a cloud environment, let's say. It's a restricted environment. So I suspect it's putting a bit of a strain on the cluster, and that's why it's taking longer than usual. But right about now.
Go ahead.
No, please continue, I interrupted you.
No. So I was just curious, like, let's say it runs low, like what are the ways to tune it on the infrastructure level? Like adding more resources to the nodes or to speed up the run?
I didn't get the question, sorry.
Yeah, so what is the way to tune the performance of the run to reduce the time? Like you've mentioned, like running in the cloud is usually faster. Is there anything else like you can do on an infrastructure level to speed it up?
Add more nodes would help very much. Pretty much that, this is a one node deployment. This is why it's putting so much strain on the cluster.
So does the depend also?
I can actually help it out a bit. If they run, is it still running? No, it's not still running. Okay, then we should be good to go. Okay, it's taking a bit longer than usual.
So does it depend on the size of the data too? Like, if the data is bigger, then it's gonna take longer?
Of course. It depends on the size of the data as well. In this particular instance, I guess it's the thing, we say that everything works right until the live demo, but it's okay. Let's give this a little bit of time to see if it gets better, and let's continue with the presentation. So moving on, and I will come back to this later. So what we saw was the whole end-to-end data science workflow from Jupyter Notebook to a compiled scalable and reproducible MLOps pipeline to running multiples of those pipelines to tune for the best hyperparameters to serving the actual model, which we will see in the end. And in all of this process, this is reproducible because we use MLMD, which is a ML metadata database by Google, which logs each pipeline steps, inputs and outputs. So you know what came from where. And in addition, we use we snapshot each step using a CSI compatible provider, like Grok in this case. And in this way, I was hoping to present you what how actually the various components of Kubeflow could be combined to give the data scientist a unified workflow. Now, moving on to another subject that I wanted to touch in this presentation is a problem called configuration management. In this part, I will introduce customized GitOps and explain how customized enables GitOps workflows for Kubeflow. Now, one of the hardest problems in Kubernetes, as I'm sure you know, is configuration management. And there is no silver bullet, and there are many tools available right now targeting this problem. Kubeflow, in particular, started out with KSonnet, which had a really high barrier of entry, and we ended up moving away from it. Whatever tool we chose had to be configurable, readable, extensible, and work well with GitOps workflows. So right now, after a lot of discussions and effort, Kubeflow uses Customize for this. So I want to give a bit of an intro to Customize so that we're all on the same page. Customize is a configuration management tool for Kubernetes, which avoids templating and domain-specific languages. Instead, it encourages writing configurations as actual Kubernetes YAMLs. Like Kubernetes is the app here. Modifications are done with patches and transformations. So to give you a reason why we didn't choose a solution like Helm, it was because charts ended up looking like this example, which is an actual chart of Grafana from the Helm charts repo. Now, I will briefly explain how Customize works so that we're on the same page. The user writes configuration as Kubernetes YAML. For example, the user here defines a deployment, a service, and a config map for Redis database. And then the user writes a customization YAML file, which imports these resources. We call this, in this situation, the base customization. Then, to render this resource, the final configuration, the user calls the customized build command. Now, let's assume that another user wants to also deploy Redis, but in a different environment, and wants to change the settings a bit. To achieve that, the user will create another customization called overlay, overlays deploy in this case, in this folder, and import the base customization and also use a patch to change the deployment's number of replicas. And again, the other user will use customized build to render the final configuration, which as you can see is a mix of the base and the overlay. However, notice that even if the final configuration is a mix of the two users' desired state, each of the users actually defines their configurations in totally separate files and folders. And this is important for what comes later in GitOps workflows. Now, we saw what Customize is. Let's talk a little bit about GitOps. So what is GitOps? Here's the deployer on our left-hand side, and the Kubernetes cluster on the right, where we want to deploy Kubeflow. Now, GitOps is all about a Git repository. It sits in the middle, and the deployer commits their desired state of the cluster, and then apply only committed manifest to the Kubernetes cluster. So their the state of their infrastructure is in the Git repo. But this is the basic configuration. But most of the times, what actually happens is that there are vendors which have their own manifests for deploying Kubeflow or any application. And there are consumers or customers who want to use these manifests, but also update them and keep up to date. So in the usual case where the manifests come from a vendor, here's what happens. For example, let's see the following example. Arecto itself implements GitOps, and we publish generic vendor manifests in a vendor repository, which is the blue one here. The deployer clones the vendor repository into a local repository, and then the deployer creates deployment specific commits, which we call customizations, on top of the vendor commits. And eventually the deployer wants to combine this manifest into the final desired state and apply it. So let's see now why customize helps the GitOps process and how the actual upgrade process happens. So one of the hardest things to do in this scenario is to answer how do you upgrade, because the deployer wants to have their own commits on top and the vendor wants to keep adding commits to upgrade their manifest. So how do you reconcile the two? For our GitOps workflows, what we do is we use Git rebase. So let's assume the vendor is at version v2 and the deployer has committed another deployment specific commit, v1. At some point in time, the vendor produces v3, another commit. The deployer pulls and rebase their changes so they can now sit on top of v3 and thus upgrade their infrastructure while also keeping their own deployment specific changes. And customize is important here because, as we said before, it separates the changes of the deployer from the changes of the vendor, so the rebase yields no conflicts. The Git rebase, that's the key point here of how customize enables us to do this workflow. So after this upgrade, the deployer just has to reapply to upgrade their cluster with a new version from the vendor. Finally, I want to talk that about the fact that it's not all good. There are some pain points in customize. I've highlighted two here. First of all, there is a feature called VARs. That is, it kind of breaks the encapsulation of customize, and the customize team actually wants to deprecate it, but there hasn't been a solution yet since last year when the planned deprecation was announced. And second, which is more like kind of the fundamental way that customize works versus something like Helm, is that in Helm, all the power is with the chart developer. The chart developer exposes knobs in the values.yaml file that the consumer can tune. On the other hand, in customize, the consumer has all the power. They can use patches and literally change anything in what they get from the vendor. But on the other hand, the developer of the customization doesn't actually have a standardized way to expose things to the consumer, like what Helm has. So it's a bit difficult to produce an easy way for consumers to actually customize their deployment, even though customize actually gives you a ton of power. So in order to find some middle ground, for our workflows at least, we thought it was it would be helpful to show that our solution was to build our own installation tool on top of the customized manifest. So I have a small video here. You can see what it looks like. On the right are our docs. On the left is the ROC deploy tool. It's what we call it. So what this does is it's essentially take you through an NCurses UX where you answer a bunch of questions. And the tool is actually responsible for converting these questions to actual customized configuration and committing them to your GitOps repo. So we are still using all of the nice things we said we were using before. We just have added a nice UI to it so that it's much more usable. And I wanted to show what this looks like. Maybe someone else has a similar problem.
I have a question. So this is
yes. Sorry.
The GitOps is basically, this is your deploying your serving part, or what is, or your whole pipeline, building your whole pipeline and basically deploying it. So you have a sort of a CI/CD workflow.
So this is about, this is separate to the CI/CD workflow. It's about initializing a deployment. So when you, when you actually take a product into your hands or a software, let's say MySQL or Grafana, you're usually given some knobs to tune, some settings. What I'm saying is that while customize gives you unlimited power to change whatever you want, it's a bit difficult to find the actual way to do it. You have to have knowledge of the whole thing. So we have built this is a small UX on top that actually asks you a few questions and produces the extra customized configuration necessary to achieve those settings. After, in addition to producing it, it also commits it to the GitOps repo. So it actually follows a GitOps process. After committing it to the GitOps repo, you can hand it off to whatever CI/CD tool you want to perform the actual reconciling with the Kubernetes cluster.
I see. Okay, so yeah, what I was trying to think it was about how you tie this together with your models and how you create your models, you build your models, and then you deploy them to serve them. And basically, was this, as I understand, this actually makes it easy for, or easier for your cluster to be set up for your whole environment, with all the different components that you need to have to set up Kubeflow.
Yes, exactly. So this is a bit of a different audience. The previous workflow we showed where you had the KLSDK in Python, which allowed you to easily serve models. This was for the data scientist to use. The second section of the talk about customizing GitOps is more for the DevOps team, let's say, the cluster deployer team, the team that is responsible for the infrastructure of Kubeflow.
Got it. Yeah. Thank you.
So I wanted to kind of show the two sides of the problem. And closing with this, thank you for giving me this opportunity. This is some contact information if you want to get in touch. And also you can try the demo yourself using this link. It was performed using something called MiniKF. It's a deployment on GCP. It's just click to deploy one button. So if you want, you can also do this link yourself, and we have instructions in this link.
Did the demo actually complete for Servin or?
Oh, yes. Ah, I forgot about it. Oh, yes, it completed. Here it is. So let me actually deliver on my promise and show you. So what I will do first is I will do a prediction for this model server. So first I define some data here, and then to actually hit the model, I call the method predict of the KF server object. So actually KL takes care of doing all the HTTP requests, et cetera, underneath, and the data scientist doesn't have to think about anything. And this, what I'm going to show you is scale to zero. Right now there is nothing running, there is no server. So once I hit enter, what actually happens is that KF serving buffers the request and spins up a pod in the background. And once the pod is ready, then it will respond to my request. And in order to make this a bit more usable for the data scientist, we have actually added the UI for the model serving. So if you print the KF server object, you will get a link for viewing the model. If I click the link, it will take me to the model UI where I can see an overview of the model server, some details, some metrics of what is happening. So this is a direct connection to Grafana. Logs from inside the pod. Here are the process data that were logged. And if you're an advanced user, the whole YAML that was used to make the server. So that's the UX that I want to show you around model serving.
Yeah, and so one question is, if you're actually setting up this in a repetitive way, you want to serve this on, this is for data scientists where they actually try and build their models, right? But then sometimes you want this to be more repeatable, like how these releases happen. So this, does Kubeflow provide a mechanism for that, or like not just going through notebooks and all these different steps that you're describing here, but more like just a push of a button and then just deploy the serving mechanism? Does that make sense?
I think so. Yes. So at the moment we don't have a UI for deploying. And the deploying is actually done through the Python SDK. So we right now we are satisfying the people who use Python a lot, but yet we don't have a UI for deploying the model. We have the UI for viewing the models and metrics around them, etc. The one we showed here. But yes, what you said is an actual thing we're working on, and it is something that is sure to be present in the later versions of Kubeflow. It's usually called, I think what you're describing is usually called the model registry.
Yeah, I think so. Like, maybe you have a registry and then you just pull that model there and then you're like, okay, I just deployed this and serve this model, right? So, it sounds a little bit like what you have with a container registry, where you build a container registry and then you publish that to the container registry. And then when you deploy it, you just deploy that container image. In this case, it would be more like the model image that you're deploying to a production environment.
Exactly. We have a weekly meeting in Kubeflow called the SIG metadata, I think, that is looking hard into this problem. So if anyone is interested more in this particular thing, I would encourage you to join this specific meeting. because it is doing work directly on the section you talked about.
Got it. Yeah, thank you. Right. So yeah, this was great. A lot of information. For me, myself, this is kind of like the first time I see the kind of end-to-end workflow. And yeah, one more question about those components. You have the ROC component. That's mm-hmm. That's an open source project.
ROC is not an open source project. But it is connected. It connects through an open source interface, like how S3 is not an open source project, but it connects through the S3 protocol that you can use an open source project for.
Got it. So, okay. And so you would not actually necessarily need that if you wanted to create your pipeline, right? So,
Yes, exactly. It's ROC is about ROC is about providing reproducibility and making workflows much easier.
Got it.
Anybody else have any questions? Anything?
Thank you for the great presentation. Qflow is a great project.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, thank you all. I'll give you back another, 15 minutes or 12 minutes. So, all right. Bye, guys.